I want to thank warmly the organizers who have invited me, and also the welcomers in Dublin for this marvelous place and moments. I would also thank Anna for her paper and presentation. Basically, I agree with her, so I will not make many criticisms, but rather comments linked with, I would say, policy context and some border between policy fields, because I think it's important. I work on borders, on, I would say, planning on borders, and the point is, when you work on borders, you really need to understand what the others do, and you need to be clear about the concepts, and this can be an issue. And I would say, it's clear that French spatial planning is linked to this aménagement du territoire, and personally, I'm fine with that, but it's interesting to underline that when you go to the European Commission, to the DG Regio, these people in the DG Regio that are mostly economists and specialists of regional development and not planning, they say, what we do is certainly not spatial planning, because they don't want to interfere with these hierarchical levels and with this subsidiarity, this sacred subsidiarity. And so I think that they do planning, probably soft planning and not hard planning, but they certainly don't want to say that. So it's important if we need to be clear about that. So in France, aménagement du territoire or planning is a multi-level and cross-sectoral thing. You explained why. It's clear that urban planning is not the same as planning at the national level. It's clear also that, and you told that clearly, I mean, the DATAR, which is this organization that makes this aménagement du territoire at national level, it's not based on master plans. It's certainly not that. It's basically DATAR. I've been working there for 6 years. It's a place of coordination, and it coordinates the different departments, these different ministries. It's a service of the Prime Minister, so it has direct access to the arbitrage, to the trade-offs that are made by the Prime Minister, and it's also a place of coordination with these regions. I mean, of course, you can tell that now there is some decentralization and state is perhaps less visible than at the time of Napoleon or even de Gaulle. But on the other hand, DATAR has clearly been an actor of that. DATAR, it was meaning aménagement du territoire and action régionale. Now it's regional attractiveness, but DATAR helped and is still helping regions to grow and to get competencies, notably through these contrats de projet État-Région, these contracts. So it's helping and it's clearly still having a big role in this vertical coordination. But it's true that there was no master plans. It could have been at a certain moment, and for reasons that I don't have the time to explain, it didn't happen. But I think that this is not so specific to France. I mean that when you think at European level, it's clear that the most you go to the upper levels, the most planning is going soft. And if you have, you don't have plans, you have perhaps visions, you have perspectives. And this, I think, is still true now. I mean, you can always, it's difficult to evaluate, you would need to have a very serious in-depth studies to say, well, at present, the state is less powerful. But Anna would be rather saying that, yes, it's less powerful. I'm not so sure, but I cannot discuss more of that, I think. But what is important is certainly what DATAR does is as well procedural and substantial. I like to use this wording, and I will take an example. It's linked with high-speed trains. Perhaps it's very French. Perhaps it's because I am myself ingénieur des ponts, that you quoted the fact that it's a very old thing. And the role of engineers in France, it would be also interesting to say a word about Saint-Simon, who inspired very much French policies, left and right. And I just want to quote that Saint-Simon, he was with Lafayette fighting at the beginning of the United States, and he came back from America saying, well, We have to end with these old things. You told this role of the politicians and also these wars and in Europe during Napoleon and so on. And what he wanted to do, he wanted to make the United States of America of Europe, the United States of Europe, and he wanted to base that on economy and on engineering against, I would say, this civic and politician organizations. And so I came back to my high-speed train. I just give an example, a little bit difficult without map, but Lille is a city north of France, very deprived because of the industrial crisis and so on. Pierre Mauroy was its mayor at the time. It was 1981-2, and he became prime minister, and he obtained the high-speed train going from Paris to London and Paris to Brussels to stop in the core of the city. If he wouldn't have acted, it would have been somewhere in the countryside. But it was in the city, and this is something which is very important for the development of cities. And how did he get that? He get that for different reasons, but basically he got that because he was acting at the local level and also at the national level. He got that because he had some influence. I mean, he didn't let the pure sectoral actors that are, for instance, the SNCF and the railway company or the Ministry of Transport, and he could counterbalance the projects of these people by having local resource, local support, and also some visions. And I don't know the story exactly, but I can tell you that when I was in Dakar, there were other discussions about the way to plan these high-speed railways, and Dakar was still acting. There was no master plan, but Dakar was able to present some prospective studies and to use many points of view of academics and so, and Dakar has still some influence, but it's soft, it's not hard, and it's not comprehensive binding planning. I cannot detail, but this is also true for many big cities in France at the moment. But you could also tell that for smaller cities where there is less political support or less empowerment at local level or less technical teams present on in the territories, then some of these cities may be a little bit forgotten in all that. Something also I would like to say is about the decentralization. It's clear that we live decentralization in France, and we will live it in the weeks or months to come, and it's good, certainly. But on the other hand, I would say that I see also more continuity what you told. And why do I say that? Because it's because I think that France is a unitary state. It's a reality that is ideological. But it's not only ideology, it's also some sort of reality. I mean, if you take the role of Paris, Paris is certainly the place of many political decisions, and it's the place where the opinion is built and so on. And you could say, okay, let's move to something else. But it's not the whole picture. Paris is also, I would say, the main pump of many flows that are, for instance, interregional migrations. In France, many people come to Paris at a certain moment and they go back to the province, to the regions. And all these systems of financing, I mean, the public budget in France is big, perhaps too big, would say some people. But I mean, it's through the welfare state, for instance, that many issues of territorial cohesion or territorial equity are solved, and this is implicit. This is the mechanism of the social welfare, and it goes through Paris. So perhaps things could evolve, but we are not a federal state. We are not Germany, and we cannot just change our urban pattern by deciding that we should do otherwise. It's not the real thing. So, perhaps I should go to the end. I wouldn't be too negative. I mean, because the risk would be to say, well, let's leave things as they are and okay. I think that we have a big challenge at the moment. Typically, I would say, as any of our states, but probably more than some, we have a financial crisis, and we have to. I wouldn't say to cut systematically all the public spends, but on the other hand, we have all these levels, and something which you didn't detail is that, for instance, in every region you have the Conseil Régional, but also the Préfet de Région. In every département you have the Conseil Général, but also the Préfet de Département. And certainly it would be possible to simplify a little bit that and to put some national civil servants to the regional or local levels. Huh? But to my mind, it wouldn't mean that the state would disappear. Because I think that the state is still necessary, because this is a unitary system, and also because when you work on borders, for instance, you need to have, when you discuss with Canton de Genève or with Basel or with the state of Luxembourg about very intense issues of cross-border cooperation, they know that they need to have the state, because the national state is responsible still of environment, of social security, and so on. So we need the state to be present. Huh? But if something should perhaps change, it's this explicitation. I'm very fond of this explicit negotiation versus implicit negotiation. It comes from a sociologist which name is Michel Crozier, and I think it's a very powerful thing. And if you want to explicit decisions and to explicit a policy process involving more the different parts of the society, the environmentalists, the economy, the citizens, then you need to explicit things. For me, it doesn't mean master plans, perhaps at local level, yes, but not at national level. But you need to have observatoire. There is a nice observatoire des territoires at the data, with a website, with many interesting publications. You need to have this prospective. We are very fond in data of prospective, which means foresight. And we need to communicate about the possible choice, the fact that there is never just one way, but perhaps there are different ways, and of course this can mean we still need planning, and so I will end by that. I think we can be optimistic about the need of planning, not necessarily plans, but certainly planning. Thank you.